One man and his pupils thought they knew the answer. Thanks in large measure to their influence, one of the great economic trends of the past 25 years has been for the welfare state to be dismantled, reintroducing people with a sharp shock to the unpredictable monster they thought they had escaped from. Risk. In 1976, a diminutive professor called Milton Friedman, working here at the University of Chicago, won the Nobel Prize in Economics.
Milton Friedman won his place in the Economic Hall of Fame by restating this simple equation, MV equals PQ, where M is the money supply, V is the velocity at which it circulates, P is the price level, and Q is the quantity of expenditures. Friedman's observation was simple. If the money supply went up, then so did the price level. Hence the quantity theory of money. But you needed much more than a piece of chalk and a blackboard to answer the second crucial question of Milton Friedman's career. What had gone wrong with the welfare state?
In Chile, he found the perfect laboratory to test his theories. In September 1973, tanks had rolled through Santiago to overthrow the government of Chile's Marxist president, Salvador Allende, whose attempt to turn the country into a communist state had ended in total economic chaos and a call by the Chilean parliament for a military coup.
There, on the balcony of the Carrera Hotel, opponents of the Allende regime celebrated with champagne as Air Force jets flew overhead to bomb the Moneda Palace. Here in the palace, Allende prepared to make a desperate last stand, armed with an AK-47 presented to him by his Cuban role model, Fidel Castro. Looking out the palace window and seeing the tanks literally rolling in, Allende realized that it was all over for his dream of a Marxist Chile. Cornered here in what was left of the presidential quarters, he took the decision to shoot himself.
Thirty-five years later, you can still see the bullet holes in some of the buildings around the square.
Hey. What happened here in September 1973 in many ways epitomized a worldwide crisis of the welfare state and posed a stark choice between alternative economic systems. With output collapsing and inflation rampant, Chile's system of universal benefits was effectively bankrupt. For Allende, the only solution was full-blown Soviet-style takeover of the entire economy. Well, the generals and their supporters knew that they didn't want that, but what did they actually want, given that the status quo was unsustainable? Enter Milton Friedman.
In March 1975, Friedman flew from Chicago to Chile to answer that question. In addition to giving lectures and seminars, Friedman came here to the Moneda Palace for a meeting with the new Chilean president, General Augusto Pinochet. Friedman spent three quarters of an hour with Pinochet, urging him to reduce the government deficit that he'd identified as the main cause of Chile's sky-high inflation, then running at an annual rate of 900%. A month after Friedman's visit, the Chilean junta announced that inflation would be stopped at any cost. The regime cut government spending by 27%. this problem of inflation is not of recent origin. It arises from trends towards socialism that started 40 years ago and reached their logical and terrible climax in the Allende regime. For tendering this advice, Friedman found himself denounced for acting as a consultant to a military dictator responsible for the executions of more than 2,000 real and suspected communists and the torture of nearly 30,000 more.
Chicago's role in Chile's new regime consisted of more than just a visit by Milton Friedman, however. Since the 1950s, there'd been a steady stream of bright young economists going from this place, the Catholic University in Santiago, to study in Chicago, and they'd come back convinced of the need to balance the budget, tighten the money supply, and liberalize trade. These were the Chicago boys, Friedman's foot soldiers. And yet the most radical of their ideas went beyond what Friedman had recommended to Pinochet. It amounted to a full-scale rolling back of the welfare state. The conservative economic revolution didn't begin in Thatcher's Britain or Reagan's America. It began right here in Chile.
The mastermind behind this wholesale dismantling of the welfare state was a young economist called José Piñera.
Chile's economy was destroyed. We have had 50 years of protectionism, state interventionism, light socialism, if you want, and then that was exacerbated during the Allende government. We had created a sort of welfare state, and that, of course, it was going bankrupt in Chile.
Between 1979 and 1981, Piñera and his colleagues erected a radically new pension system for Chile, giving every worker the chance to opt out of the old pay-as-you-go state system. Instead of a payroll tax, each worker now could put 10% of his wages aside into an individual personal retirement account to be managed by private competing companies. There was also a small premium for disability and life insurance. The idea was to give each worker a sense that the money being put aside was his own property, his own capital.
Piñera gambled. He gave workers a choice: stick with the old system of pay-as-you-go or opt for the new personal retirement accounts. It paid off. Convinced by Piñera's argument, 80% made the switch to a private pension plan.
But was it worth it? Was it worth the huge moral compromise that the Chicago boys and the Harvard man made when they got into bed with a torturing, murderous dictatorship? Well, the answer to that question very much depends on whether you think their reforms helped pave a peaceful way back to a sustainable democracy in Chile. And I think they did.
In 1980, Pinochet conceded a new constitution that prescribed a 10-year transition back to democracy. 10 years later, he stepped down as president. Democracy was restored. And by that time, the economic miracle was underway that helped to ensure its survival. For the pension reform not only created a new class of property owners, each with his own retirement nest egg, it also gave the Chilean economy a massive shot in the arm.
These brokers at the Banco de Chile are investing Chilean workers' pension contributions into the stock market, and they've been doing a pretty good job of it. Average returns on the personal retirement accounts has been over 10%, reflecting the fact that in the 20 years after 1987, the Chilean stock market has gone up by a factor of 18.
The There is a downside to the system, to be sure. Since not everyone in the economy has a regular full-time job, not everyone ends up participating in the system, which leaves a substantial chunk of the population with no pension coverage at all.
I'm standing in front of the Communist Party headquarters here in La Victoria, a suburb of Santiago which was once one of the hotbeds of opposition to the Pinochet regime. Because most people here are either unemployed or work in the informal sector, they don't or can't pay into the pension system, which means they don't get anything out of it. This is the kind of neighborhood where Che Guevara is still the local hero, not Jose Piñera.
The poor of Chile may not have a private pension plan and may have to make do with a meager government handout in their old age. But even they've benefited from Chile's rapidly growing economy.
Growth makes a difference in the life of every citizen. The poverty rate in Chile has gone down from around 50% to 13% now. So this has been really a huge success, and the pension reform has been a critical element in this.
The improvement in Chile's economic performance since the Chicago Boys reforms is really very hard to argue with. In the 15 years before Milton Friedman's visit, the growth rate here was a measly 0.17% a year. In the subsequent 15 years, it increased by a factor of nearly 20. The poverty rate here is down to 15%, compared with 40% in the rest of Latin America. And when you look down at Santiago's shiny new financial district, you can see why the Chilean pension reform has been imitated right across the region, and indeed around the world.